Hello everyone. Welcome to the Crack Admission in Top B School webinar part 2. This part will be covering profile evaluation and resume building. My name is Arindam and I shall be the host of this webinar and will take you forward in terms of explaining how a profile is evaluated by Top B Schools and how can you make effective changes in your resume so that it really stands out in the competition. For the ones who have joined us for the first time, I request you to go back to part one and have a look at what we had discussed in the first part of the webinar, where we talked about how do you crack interviews in top business schools. Let's move ahead. So the agenda which I want to discuss today is typically talk about profiles and how admission committees of top business schools look at profiles of every individuals. How are they evaluated? What is measured? What really stands out? What doesn't work? What works? So we'll try and look and understand in terms of the basic alignment of every profile and how does an admission committee look into it. Then briefly, we'll also touch upon the importance of resume. And resume is something which we will talk in slightly greater detail because one, we'll talk about the importance in the overall context of the admission process. Why do you need a resume? How does one pager resume really talk about you from a candidature perspective? Finally, I'll also give you, before ending the webinar, some sure shot success takeaways, and you wouldn't want to miss this. These are tips, these are small snippets, small changes that you can do to make your resume stand out and make it really amazing from the bunch of resumes that people see day in, day out. So let's first start understanding why is profile evaluation needed. Now, even before we start getting into the nitty-gritties of it, let's understand the first point. How many seats are there in the top B school? So the number of seats in the top B school, and when I say top B schools, I'm just not considering only the IIMs in the country. So it is the IIMs in the country along with, let's say, colleges like SPJAN, MDI, FMS, XLRI. So like that, we are considering around top 20, 25 institutions of the country. And when you try and see the number of seats that are in offer from these top B schools, they will not be more than 10,000. And with the number of candidates writing, and I'm taking the example of CAT here, number of candidates writing would be close to, let's say, 2.5 lakhs. So just from a probability perspective, you have around 4% chance of success. So every 100 people who are writing the test, only 4 will have a chance to get inside the top B school. And that's one of the most important reason why profile evaluation becomes critical aspect of every evaluation. If your profile is not fitting into the whole scheme of things, you are basically not there in the top business school. And you also need to look at it this way. If there is 4% chance of success, we are also saying there is 96% chance of rejection. So in short, since the demand and supply is a bit skewed, the demand is the supply of candidates is very less in terms of the people who are trying to get into, but the demand is extremely high, because of which your percentage chance is reduced. The second reason why profile evaluation is needed is the point to find the best fit in terms of candidature. Now, when you say best fit in terms of candidature, we are looking at people who completely absorb into the whole atmosphere of business school, people who belong there, people who have the right set of skills. So when the admission committee looks at your resume, looks at your CAT score, looks at your academics profile, the kind of work you have done, they're basically trying to assess how fit are you as a candidate to be a part of that business school. And another thing which we will stress upon slightly later in the webinar is the point of differentiating your profile from others. If you put a run-of-the-mill profile, then differentiation is not really there and people will not find you interesting enough to get noticed. The third reason of profile evaluation comes from the fact that B school also has a reputation to protect. Now, these business schools over the years have been institutions of great achievements. They have given wings to the aspirations of millions of people, of people who aspire to be in the top elite class of the society. So when a candidate gets into business school, there are certain aspirations that a candidate has. And the B school would also try and understand if the aspirations can be met by the type of culture that the institute has. So if your aspirations are wavered, if your aspirations in terms of your career vision are not really narrow, not really well thought of, then again, your profile will not be considered. The fourth point is, and that's kind of an overlap with the third point, wherein we see that the candidate has to fit into the culture of the business school. Now, when you say culture, you're talking about the ethos, the legacy, the kind of things that these business schools stand for. For instance, a business school might really put a lot of emphasis on people who exhibit leadership qualities. Some business schools might really put in a lot of emphasis on characteristics related to entrepreneurship. How much entrepreneurship characteristics do you show in your day-to-day life? So typically, culture is something which is very individual as far as these business schools are concerned, and they would want to see whether you fit into their shoes to take their brand forward. The last and one of the most important points of profile evaluation is also to see how much as a candidate can you bring value to the whole class. Now, you can get into an institution, and if the institution is not getting benefited from your candidature, then essentially one seat is wasted. So the whole point of looking at a candidate is also to see how much value are you bringing to the class? How much value are you bringing to the peer group? What skills can be transferred? What skills can be learned from you so that there is a mutual collaboration of learning and growing, and it is not just a one-way event. So these are the major five reasons why profile evaluation is the need from an admission committee standpoint. Now let's spend some time in terms of understanding what is it that they're trying to evaluate through this. Now, essentially, I have broken this whole point of evaluation into two different pieces. One are the primary factors, the factors that you can't really do much about. And the second are the essential factors. Now, the primary factors are the ones which have a very qualitative and quantitative approach to them. For example, the first one says consistent academic records. Now, academic records from your 10th, 12th and graduation play a tremendous amount of role in terms of deciding how have you been as a candidate throughout your life. How serious have you been from your studies perspective? How much you have learned, how much you have scored? Because from a yardstick point of view, that's an important point to understand for the admission committee. So consistent academic records, very, very important, and the first point of evaluation. The second is obviously high test scores. How much percentile are you scoring in exams like CAT, ZAT, NMAT, IFT? Are you a 90 percentile? Are you a 95? Are you scoring 98, 99? So the amount of percentage is directly proportional to the aptitude level that you have. And higher the test score, better are your chances of getting a call. The third point, which is very quantitatively evaluated here, is the work experience. And when I say work experience, it's not just the number of years that you've worked. So basically within work experience, you'll have two different benchmark or yardstick. One is the quality of your experience. What kind of work have you done? How has it impacted people? Has there been instances where you have gone on and shown leadership potential in your work? What is the relevance of the work from a business standpoint? Now, if you say that your work is very reactive and all that you did for X number of years was to obey the orders from your manager, then it is not something which comes out as a very qualitative work. It just comes across as someone who likes to obey and plays around his comfort zone. So the point of quality and relevance is absolutely critical when somebody is trying to talk about his work experience. The fourth is the career aspiration. So career aspiration here refers to the point of the need of an MBA. The business schools would really want to understand through, let's say, a statement of purpose or through essays or through form filling. They would try and understand why do you need MBA in the first place? How have you zeroed down from multiple options today that exists for career growth by saying that, okay, I don't need this, but I definitely need MBA. So the point, the need of an MBA is the point that admissions committee look at very closely. Next point is the impact. Now, impact is a very strong word. Typically, these admission committees would want to know how have you, what kind of impact have you created around you? So it could be personal, it could be personally impacting a lot of people around you, or it could be professionally. Basically, they want to know that who are you as an individual? Do you really work for your own pleasure, or you really help people along with you? Do you take up, do you take in the pressure, or do you just leave the pressure like that? Do you crumble under pressure, or do you deliver with the team along with you? So the point of impact is extremely crucial. Looking at people from the point of how much value they have created in and around them in their whole ecosystem is again another very important point from an evaluation standpoint. The last but not the least is what we very commonly refer as co-curricular and extracurricular activities. They want to see how what you have done beyond academics. Have you done something within the academic region outside, let's say, only your studies? So have you written any research papers? Have you done any kind of case study competitions? Have you taken part in competitions which need you to think and come out as a problem solver? From an extracurricular standpoint, they're looking at people who have done different things. So have you done any form of activities like, let's say, swimming, or have you been a national level athlete, or you've done something on a national level or at a regional level which stands other than your academic criteria? So extracurricular activities, achievements, extremely crucial to segregate the candidature in itself, because that tells me that the versatility of the candidate also is kept in the mind. And also we are saying that since I'm versatile, higher are my chances to really understand business and flourish well in the career. So all in all, if you look at the whole primary factors in the whole application process, it will have around 70% of weightage. There are certain soft skills part of it. These are skills which do not have a very quantitative understanding, but having them are extremely essential for you to convince the admission committee that you are the right fit. So one is definitely your personality fitment. Who are you as an individual? Do you align with the kind of work you would want to do? The admissions committee would never want to hire someone, or would never want to take in someone who's extremely rude or who's extremely short-tempered. So from a personality standpoint, very important to show your fitment towards the business. Skill set alignment is also one more thing, and that again has a kind of overlap between the aspiration. So these admission committees are looking at people who have a strong alignment in terms of skill sets. So somebody who wants to today get into marketing is not really open in terms of ideating or articulating his thoughts and ideas is not really aligned in terms of skill sets. Somebody who wants to make a career in finance, let's say somebody wants to become a financial analyst at one of the top banks, but fears the whole point of crunching numbers, is not really aligned in terms of skill sets. So skill set alignment is very crucial when you're trying to put an application forward. Community service, it's not like a must have component in your application, but community service is looked upon as something which is done outside your comfort zone. What are you giving back to the society? Are you doing anything other than what's needed of you from a personal or a professional standpoint? So community service, good if you do it, brownie points for you, but not something which is a must have. So it really doesn't affect your chances in case you don't have it. Business awareness and relevant certifications. Now, business awareness typically refers to the point of, do I understand business at large? Can I look at my economy and say why a certain thing is happening? Can I talk about, let's say, the trade between India and China? So in terms of awareness of business at large is another important factor that they're trying to evaluate. Because at the end of the day, you have to understand that this is a business course. And when you talk about a formal management education, you are talking about people who understand business ground up. So somebody with a very vague understanding would not really make the cut. Relevant certifications are like a good way to trade off if your academic records are not very good. So there are two ways of trading off your certifications. One is if you don't have a very consistent ACADS, you can then show your relevant certifications in terms of proving them that there is a certain path in your mind and you're following those certifications in terms of getting there. The other point is, if somebody is trying to get into a career switch, so for example, today I am into sales. So my whole genre of work is negotiations, selling, persuasions, sales strategies, creating pipelines, lead generation, so on and so forth. But if my interest lies tomorrow to become, let's say, a financial analyst, my current role will really not help me to move into financial analysis. But if I do a relevant certification on, let's say, understanding how to make financial models, understanding how to read balance sheets, how to create profit and loss statements, if I have relevant certifications like those, that can also be used as an important yardstick to show that I am fit enough to get into a career which is outside of what I'm doing today. So typically on an evaluation level, the essential factors are around 30% of the weightage. So when your whole application combines these two, that's when it gets really interesting and people are then shortlisted based on the factors that we have discussed. Now, so far we talked about how profile evaluation is extremely important and how the admissions committee of business schools look at your profile and try and select the best fit into their institutes. Now, from now, I will be talking more from the point of resume building. Now, resumes are like the reflection of your candidature. And I've spoken about this before when I've said that resumes speak about you. So if your resume is not written well, then essentially the whole chances of getting selected are hampered. Let's look at this graph. Now, if I were to understand the importance of resume from a graph wherein I'm trying to look at the point of resumes from the weightage that it has to the importance that it has in the admission process. And I'll see that although there are no black and blue weightage given for a good resume, but it stands at a very high importance level in terms of admission process. Now, what does that mean to you as a candidate, as an aspirant? Now, what it really says is that although resume doesn't have a number attached to it in terms of the weightage in the admission process, but if you do not have a well-written resume, then you are essentially blocking your chance of getting into a top business school. And as we move on, we'll talk about the different mistakes that people do in creating their resumes and how you can overcome that. I would also like to place a slight emphasis here that the point of this webinar from a resume perspective is not to really teach you how to make a resume. The idea is you already have a resume. You have seen a resume. You know what are the different aspects come. So you know that career objective, education details, work experience, extracurriculars, achievements, all those you know are a part of the resume building. But what I am trying to do today is to really tell you that how can you really make impactful changes in your existing resume so that you are more meaningful, you are more differentiated, and you have that X factor when it comes around getting selected from a bunch of people. Let's look at few factors which I've noticed in my tenure and how can you really stand out in the competition. So the first point, what I've tried to do here is make a comparison of how people normally write it versus how can you do some subtle changes around the whole area, and that will drastically make the look and feel much more clearer. Let's look at the first point. Now, typically, career objective is something which people are obsessed in writing, especially in India. If you look at resumes and CVs in India, be it a fresher, be it somebody with work experience, people are obsessed with writing career objective. Now, if you have a very strong aligned objective of what you want to achieve, that's absolutely fair to write it in a CV. But if you make a point where you say that I want to work in an organization where I can add value by utilizing my technical and non-technical skills, now such statements only tell me two things. One, you're not clear about your objective. You're only making lofty statements for the heck of it. Number two, it also tells me that you're not really tailored or really not really understood the kind of work that you want to do as you go ahead. So the problem with this run-of-the-mill writing career objective is the fact that you're not giving any form of clarity, or you're not telling me any form of expertise that you have which differentiates you as a candidate. Now, if I were to just change the whole career objective and put it in a way that it makes more sense and adds slightly more credibility to my profile, so in that case, a professional synopsis makes a lot of sense. For example, if I were to address the career objective in a slightly different way for somebody who has, let's say, around 4 to 6 years of experience into selling and pre-sales, would be something like this. Seasoned professional with 5 years of experience in handling various small to mid-sized teams for solution management and client engagement activities, actively seeking a challenging role in a reputed organization to contribute and add value. Now, what that has done is, although the length is slightly bigger than the length of your career objective in the previous part, it has done two things. One, it has told me exactly who I am. And it has also told me what I'm really good at. So when I have told that, then it makes a lot of sense to put it on the top as a synopsis. And therefore, the chances of noticing it and somebody acknowledging the fact that you're good at a certain area is far more as compared to writing something very generic by saying that I will utilize my technical or non-technical skills. So the point here is to understand that too much of a generic content really doesn't appeal to any of you. Now, let's be honest. If you were to look at this CV, would you select this candidate? If you were to look at this CV and multiple CVs like this, which only talk from a very generic point of view, the point of being generic also gives me a reason that somebody really doesn't understand the whole business ecosystem or the dynamics of the way functions and roles evolve and work. But with the suggested approach, you can clearly understand that somebody has a very clear alignment towards the kind of work he has done and the kind of work he intends to do in the future. So that's the first takeaway. The second takeaway, which I've seen a lot of people making mistakes, is focusing too much on your current functional expertise. Now let's understand this. Now, you might be an engineer who has done engineering in, let's say electrical or electronics or civil mechanical mining. The irony in India is that half of you, or in fact, most of you, will be placed in an IT industry. Now, after a few years in working in the IT industry, let's say 2.5 years, you realize that you have picked up certain skills, which is really helping you to grow faster in your environment. So let's say you could be good at C, you could be good at the knowledge of coding, you could be good at development of codes. So you could be good at, let's say, languages like C, C++, Java, mainframes, .NET, so on and so forth. Or you could have picked up skills like business modeling, financial modeling at Excel. You can make good PPTs. So the point here to understand is your current functional expertise will only take you to a certain level. And why are these called current functional expertise? Is because this is the expertise that you currently need in order to excel in your work. But understand this point. You are applying to a college wherein they will hire you for the potential which they see in you that will make you a great business leader in the future. So the point of somebody selecting you is the investment that they're trying to make in the potential that they see today in the present. So if you do not really tell me in terms of leadership qualities what you have, in terms of what makes you different and how are you different from just someone who can code or make PPTs or Excel, then you're not really making a very valid point. So the problem here is that too much focus on current expertise will dilute the effect of your leadership potential. Because you need to understand that the business schools are hiring you for your business impact and not for the fact that you're a good coder. Because had you been a good coder, you wouldn't want an MBA in the first place. So avoid talking too much from a current functional expertise. Instead, what you can do is focus on leadership skills or leadership potential. Now, why have I put the word potential is to emphasize on the point that most of you might not really be holding a position of leadership or authority or decision making today. But that doesn't stop you to do things which add value, which create impact within your surroundings. So the potential which creates a differentiation in terms of what you have done other than what was told to you is what I called as leadership potential. Use examples where you have come across as a leader. Use examples where you have solved problems. Talk about areas, highlight examples where you have done something which was not expected out of you, but you came out and took that responsibility to take the team ahead. The point here is to understand that whenever you're trying to focus or highlight your skill sets, try and talk more from a leadership standpoint and leadership highlights rather than focusing too much on functional expertise. You can also talk about the emotional quotient. Now, emotional quotient is another important facet of being a manager or a leader as you go ahead, because then you are not doing things alone or in a team. You have a huge number of people who are under you, and therefore being sensitive to the requirements, sensitive to their understanding is of primary importance. And as I've told you in when we were doing profile evaluation, that business schools really don't need people who are not aligned to the core understanding of running a successful business from a personality standpoint. So if as a personality, if you have done things which exhibit high level of emotional quotient, then that's something you should definitely highlight in the application. The next point which I'm sure you would agree to me, and I have seen that written for very long, is the point of using jargons of specific industry type. Now, mostly since we are living in a service dominated industry where IT, ITS is around 70% of the jobs in the market today, you will see a lot of jargons that aspirants and candidates put in their CVs. For example, if you read, it says extensively worked on PVDM module to ensure timely deliverables. Now, if I were to review this, I have no clue what PVDM is, and I'm sure neither do you. Now, if I were to ask this candidate who's sitting in front of me, he might say that PVDM could be one of his core business modules that he's working on in terms of creating an application out of it. Now, the point is, as an admissions officer, what value is it giving me when I read this line? It absolutely gives me nothing. And you also need to understand who is reviewing your CV in the first place. These are people from HR background. They might really not be aligned to the technical skill sets. So if you were to use the same jargons that you use in your industry, in your day-to-day work, you're essentially not contextualizing it for the reader. And with the lack of contextualization, the impact is not known, and therefore I'll not be able to understand what is the point of talking about extensive work and timely deliverables. A better way would be to focus on whether this type of work involved teamwork, leadership, or did you do it alone? It basically, if you were to put this whole work in a sense that it gives me a feeling that it was a team effort, it involved a bit of leadership, or were you the one who was handling it alone? So point is to show the impact of your work in the overall context. If the impact is not coming out, then all these sentences are just run-of-the-mill sentences which do not give me any form of understanding around it. For example, instrumental in increasing the customer satisfaction ratings from 4.4 to 4.8 on a scale of 5 by working extensively on client requirements. What I have done is I've changed into a pointer which gives the impact, the value of the work, and therefore has a strong amount of context when the reader is reading it. You don't have to have a previous background to either understand modules or jargons. But this line clearly tells you that because of the work, the kind of work that you did, the impact was that the CSAT ratings increased from, let's say, 4.4 to 4.8 on a scale of 5. And that in itself is a huge amount of impact that happened because of your work. Another thing which people make a lot of mistake is the point of writing each and every point of their work. So they will write about project 1, project 2, responsibilities, areas of responsibilities handled,